Okay, I've never done this before, so let's see how this works. Hello, how are you? I am sitting here reading, and I thought I would share some stuff that I was working on, but there's music in the background. I don't know if you can hear that. I didn't mean for that to happen. So I am reading, I've been telling people that I would get live, and I'm just sitting here and reading Euripides, finishing up Andromache. It's the first one. And it's pretty much a lot of dialogue between Menelaus and Andromache, and at the end, Peleus and Thetis. It's kind of sad, so it takes place after the Trojan War. But this is part of the research that I'm doing for the fourth book, the White Island. And you can see I'm just sitting here in the kitchen, trying to work on processing all this information. So, how are you doing out there? See you. Nova wrote it. All good. I'm gonna hit the little wave button. I never did this before. It's kind of weird. It feels weird. Can you see me and hear me? Hi. How you doing? Yay! So I was just saying that I'm reading Euripides, the Andromache, the first play. There's three in here: Andromache, Hecuba, and the Trojan Women. So this is part of my research for the fourth book, The White Island. And all these plays take place after the Trojan War ends. So, hi. Oh my gosh, JJ Carmichael, haven't seen you in a minute. How you doing? Down there in Southern Cal. Yay! Hi, she wields books. How you doing? This is the first time I've ever done live on Facebook, but I'm trying to like get over myself because I get embarrassed when I have to do any kind of video. But I'm trying to keep myself honest because the last book that I'm writing is like killing me. I don't know what it just... it's just so huge, and there's so many things that I'm trying to incorporate. So, if you've read the other books, then you know that I pretty much ended, well, not to be a spoiler, so it's a spoiler if you haven't done it, but at the end of book three, you know, we have the death of Achilles, and then the aftermath, the war has to finally end in Troy. And, eventually, like all the men that survive take the Trojan women captive, and they just divide them up like war prizes, and it's pretty heinous, right? They're raped, they have children by the Greeks, and it wreaks havoc when they get back to their homeland. So I'm about halfway through this play for about the second time, and I write little notes. You guys can see, like, I write all over the place. But in this one, we have Andromache has been married off to Neoptolemus, who is Achilles' son by Deidamia. And he is also married to Hermione, which is Menelaus's youngest daughter by Helen. And Hermione can't have any children. And Andromache, who could only have one child, Astyanax, by Hector, and that child was killed at the end of the war. Anyway, so she can't have any babies. She's jealous of Andromache, who's had a son by Neoptolemus. And anyway, so Menelaus comes to her rescue, and because she asks her dad to come and basically kill Andromache, and that's exactly what he does. So he goes to Phthia, and he's
arguing with
well, I'm gonna back up. So and you know, if you guys have any questions, you could throw them at me too, so I don't know. And anyway, so Andromache is basically pinned to an altar of Thetis by Menelaus, and she's hanging on to the feet of the altar to get saved. And she's sent word to Peleus, she's sent word to Neoptolemus, and nobody has come to her rescue. So she's at the mercy of Menelaus, who is telling her, look, you know, I'm going to kill you because you're pissing off my daughter. And, thank you. She rules books. Thank you. I didn't know if you guys could hear that or not. I don't know what it is. I think it's my Pandora. I hope I don't get dinged for that. But, yeah. So, I can't see what that was. I want to say was that Chronicles of Narnia or something? I don't know. It's my Ennio Morricone station on Pandora. That's what I read and write to. So, anyway, Hector, Andromache is, Menelaus is intent on killing Andromache. And he says that whatever my daughter wants to do with your son, she's probably going to want to kill him. And that's fine. So you're dead and your son is dead. So she's been waiting for some kind of rescue. And let me see. There was a part in here where I was like, dang. What was it? Oh. He says Menelaus says, tells the servants to take hold of her, and he says, I have you now, and I hold out your son's death to make you leave the goddess's holy altar. And with that threat, I drew you to the slaughter. So he's what an asshole, man. When I wrote the book, I really hated Menelaus. I thought he was a turd, and he was just like weak in spirit. Hi, Jenny for NZ. How you doing? I'm gonna hit the little wave thing. So Menelaus was just such an asshole about it, and using a woman's child or anybody's child to basically, like, it just to use them as a weapon against them. I would just want to kill somebody if somebody was making that kind of a threat to, like, one of my kids or my grandkids or something like that. And he says, he's like, if you don't get away from the altar, if you don't come away from Thetis's altar, then, you know, I'm going to kill your son. Well, of course, she lets go of the altar, and then he's like, hey, I got you now. And so that this lie has delivered you into my hands, and that's how it's going to be for you, he says. You understand. As for your child, my child, meaning his daughter, will decide whether to kill him or not. So get inside that house, and your behavior, he's saying that basically that you're, oh, thank you, Jenny. Basically, you're a slave here. You know, you are the concubine of Neoptolemus. So you don't even get it. You don't get a say here. Like, what are you doing? You crazy bitch. And you're a slave, and you need to learn respect. All the while, he's threatening to kill her son and tell her that I'm going to let my daughter kill your son. I'm going to kill you. And she says, you sneak, I've been deceived, and you've lied to me. And I'm like, this is who Menelaus is, man. He's a liar from the get-go. And he tells her, he goes, I don't deny it. Go ahead, tell everybody, announce it. What do I care? And I really like this part where Andromache says, there's a question? Is that what that is? What inspired your writing Greek mythology? Oh, that's a great question. Everyone watching will see it on the screen. So, can everybody see that? So what inspired me? I have always liked Greek mythology, and what really got my attention to it was when I was working on my master's in history. I studied Alexander the Great, and one of the stories about Alexander was that he carried a copy of the Iliad around with him, and he carried it under, kept it under his pillow. So I imagine like a big old fat scroll, right? Like wrapped up, because they didn't have like books, I don't, like the way we think of books, right? So I'm thinking he had like a scroll or scrolls or something, I don't know, tucked under his pillow. That's the story. I believe it was Plutarch tells us that story. So that's what, and that was history. So I really liked Alexander and the stories about him. So then I started thinking, well, what I knew kind of about the Trojan War, but I hadn't really studied it. But that's what got me into reading about the Trojan War, was that particular aspect of Alexander's life, like what would inspire him, and then the correlation between Alexander and Hephaestion with Achilles and Patroclus. So I was really curious about, you know, what that relationship was like. So that's pretty much what got me into this part, the Trojan War. And then I had, and actually the Iliad, I like the Iliad, I actually started reading the Odyssey first. So I've read, oh, let me show you my other one. Sorry. This is the other, I'm using this one. So if you listen to my podcast, you've heard me read out of this book. This is Emily Wilson's translation. She's the first woman to translate the Odyssey. So I've read several other versions, but I came to the Odyssey first, and that was a story I related to before I got into the Iliad. So, and I just felt like the characters and the stories were so powerful, and they spoke to me about aspects of our humanity and the tragedy. I'm kind of drawn to dark things and tragedy because I think life is kind of fucked up sometimes. And that, you know, we have to deal with that kind of stuff. And that's what makes it real, right? Life is kind of raw. And we muddle through sometimes, and things happen, bad things happen to good people, and good things happen to bad people. And then why do we have to judge what's good or bad, except for I'm gonna judge Menelaus all day long because he's a jerk. I don't like Menelaus. So that's kind of how I got into it. Just, I used to teach in college too. So I used to talk about how the ancient stories speak to us about what does it mean to be human and archetypes and things like that. So that's kind of how I got into it. And I fell in love with retelling the stories, and that's how I got to this point. So yeah, thanks for the question. That was a good one. That made me think about some stuff, so good. Let's see, where was I with, oh, I was going to share this part. Okay, so about aspects of being human. There is a part, a little quote in here that Andromache says, that children are our life, our heart, and our soul. And that's true for everyone. And some people who have no experience find children tiresome. They may have less pain, but they are blessed with the fortune of being truly unfortunate. And I thought, wow, that's pretty powerful. That says something about how we relate to, how parents might relate, not might, but how parents relate to their children. And that when, you know, she's saying that your life might be easier without kids. And if you've ever raised, my opinion personally about humanity was little kids were easier, and when they got to be teenagers, it was like, oh my God, teenage in high school was much harder, I thought. Anyway, so you might not have you might have all your freedom, right, if you don't have kids or something. And no offense to anybody who doesn't, I don't mean any of that. So, some people just, you know, like people will say to me, oh, what grade do you teach? I teach high school. I teach reading and history in high school and English also. So, Like, oh, ooh, high school, feel sorry for you. I'm like, I like the kids. It's good. Anyway, I just thought that was an interesting quote in there about having kids and not having kids, and Menelaus having caused the death of his brothers because he had to go chase Helen, right? So he's indirectly the cause of Agamemnon having to sacrifice Iphigenia. And so there's a lot of like play on that kind of that relationship and really what a jerk is that Menelaus is. So let's see, where was the part I have written it in here? Helen had, or Hermione had a bunch of stuff to say. She basically says, you know, you're a tramp and you're sleeping with my husband and you're giving him kids, and that means that he doesn't want to come to my bed. And I'm thinking, he don't want to come to your bed, man, because you're a bitch. But we can't forget that Andromache is a slave, so it's not it's not a love match. There's no indication. Sexual slave, and she laments the loss of Hector quite a bit. She said it's a disgrace. We do have this disease. We're worse than men, but we know how to put up a good front. Oh, Hector, oh, my love, the things I did for your sake. She just mentions that she tries to remind Menelaus that, you know, she might be a slave here, but she was a queen and she was powerful in Troy, and she's more than that. She had been more than that. And of course Menelaus is just like, I don't care. And let's see, and she does go to Thetis for shelter, and eventually Peleus arrives. Oh my gosh, that's a good one. And when he shows up, they have him, like, because he's old at this point. He's like really old, and he's like, he's carrying the scepter. He's using it as a walking stick. And she says, I sent for you countless times, and they've dragged me to the altar of Thetis. And where have you been? And he basically, she's, when, and I talk about this in my books, there's a thing in ancient Greece where they wrap their arms around the knees, and it's called being a supplicant. So it's begging. So she's begging, and she says, I'm begging you. The play says Andromache falls to her knees in supplication, and I'm begging you, old man, I'm falling down before your knees. I cannot use my hand to touch your beloved beard. And that's because her hands are bound. She's been taken, you know, prisoner by Menelaus. And she says, please, by the gods, save me. If you don't, we'll die. And that would mean a disgrace for you and for me and our misfortune. And that made me think of a piece of art that I know, and you guys may have seen it too, where Thetis is at the knees of Zeus. And when she goes to beg him for Achilles' sake, after Patroclus has been killed, spoiler alert, but you know, and that just reminds me of that image of Thetis at Zeus's knees, reaching up and touching his beard. So I don't know, there's a lot of imagery that I get that crosses different storylines. And Menelaus is still bossing Peleus around in Phthia, and he says, are you going to come and rule my household too? Like, you rule in Sparta, isn't that enough? And Peleus says, and he says, well, I took her captive. I'm the one who brought her from Troy. And Peleus reminds her that, yeah, but now she's my grandson's war prize. So again, right, she is being used as a manipulation. And then Peleus goes on this diatribe against Menelaus. He says, are you a man? You're the worst, descended from trash. He says, you're a piece of trash. How do you figure as a man? You let your wife go to Troy, leaving your house unlocked and her bed unguarded. And she was the worst of all. He says that, and once you discovered that she was trash, you should have spat her out, not set the spears in motion. So he's just really, like, just going after Helen. And that's, you know, we could say that was slut-shaming. She was definitely, at least in my book, she was definitely under the power of Aphrodite. And I see Aphrodite as a all the gods are manipulators, right? So they manipulate all the humans to do what they want them to do, regardless of the consequence that the people that they're manipulating have to deal with in the end. And so anyway, he calls her a bunch of trash, and you should have let her stay there in Troy, right? You should have paid good money, wages, to keep her from coming home. Like, you should have gave them money to hang on to her. But that's not how the wind blew in your mind, and a lot of brave men's souls you destroyed. You've made a lot of old women childless and taken noble sons from their old gray-haired fathers, and I'm one of those, much to my grief. And he says, in my eyes, he says, you're Achilles' murderer. You're polluted. You're the one who came back home unscathed from Troy. Your armor all beautiful and shining and wrapped up in its fine case, just like when you left home. And that is like the biggest insult. Now, having read the Iliad, and if you read my books, then, you know, the accusations leveled at Menelaus are that he doesn't fight, but really he does. Whether or not he hangs back a lot, I don't know how true that would be, but it's definitely an insult to say that your armor is all shiny and new, just like it was 10 years ago, or at this point more like 15 years ago. And you know, the idea that, I think if we've all seen maybe the 300, and she's like, you know, come back with your shield or on it, and that was very much, hi Michael Joseph Fraser, how you doing, that would have been that's just a complete diss. That's, you know, you're not a warrior, you're just a coward. And that is something that also Achilles accuses Menelaus and Agamemnon of doing, that you are definitely, you know, you hang back, like, I'm doing all the work for you. That's what Achilles was telling Agamemnon. I do all the work for you, and how dare you try to take my prize, Briseis. Again, well, that's a whole other story, I guess I'll have to get into. Kind of, and he says, Peleus then goes on and says, I told my grandson, so I told Neoptolemus, not to form a marriage bond with you and not to take this filly of an evil woman, for mothers display the faults in future generations. And I was like, whoo, that's pretty harsh. And it makes me think about, again, going back to the great question that I was asked. Hi, nice, thank you. thanks, Michael. We talk a lot now about trauma being transferred generationally, and I find it interesting to have this comment from hundreds of years ago. And we have the adage, right, the apple doesn't fall far from the tree. It's like, where do we get that? So we have an observation among writers, artists, of the idea that, and even in the Bible, right, the Old Testament, the sins of the father are visited upon the son. And I don't know what Old Testament book that comes from, but I just remember that from Bible study long ago. So just the idea that what transpires in a parent can be, or grandparent, right, is transferred to, like, parent and child and further down the generations. I don't know how I want to work that into my book, but I did mark that, as you could see right there. That would be lines, that's line about 635 to into like 642-ish or so in the Andromache from Euripides. But I find that an interesting concept, that even in the ancient world, to be talking about character traits basically being passed down. And I see, and specifically when we read like the Little Iliad, hi Mitch, when we read the little Iliad, we see that the house of Atreus is cursed, and that the curse is from Agamemnon and Menelaus's father. And so that curse was visited on the sons, which was then visited upon their families, meaning and the women that they married. And obviously, Clytemnestra had a very tragic life. Helen really has a tragic life. And both of those women, Clytemnestra and Helen, are often vilified in the mythologies, in the stories, the way we look at them. I took that. I'm not done with Helen by any means, because Helen goes into book four, The White Island, and we're gonna get to see her and hear a lot more of what's going on with her as she has to come back and reconcile with the life that she left. She wanted a different life, and there was that scene where I wrote where she realized that when Paris finally told her the truth, I think it was Rise of Princes, and he says it was really, I was promised you. You were given to me as a prize from a contest with the three goddesses, Hera, Athena, and Aphrodite, who was the fairest. And I went with Aphrodite, and she promised me the most beautiful woman in the world. And I just didn't know it was gonna be you. And then when I met you, when I went to visit Sparta, then I knew. And so I kept that a secret from Helen in my books. I've never read anywhere that it was revealed to her. So I would think, how could you imagine, like, your whole life, you think it's your choice, and you realize that, oh my God, you mean from the time I was born, I was fated to have these yearnings of never being satisfied with my fucking life, and now I'm in this shit show. Like, look, I left my daughter, I left a husband who maybe I didn't love him, but I had a whole life, and I left it for what? I think that might just turn you hateful, you know, and bitter. And then to be compelled, it's like being compelled in a toxic relationship, right? So she and Paris really have a toxic relationship that's being manipulated by Aphrodite. So I don't know where I'm just rambling a little bit. Back to the DNA traits. So I think that it's very interesting to see that in an ancient text. He says, I'll skip that part. I'm not trying to bore you guys with the whole freaking play. I should probably just do a podcast about this one too. I wish I was more prolific. I know I've been getting a lot of messages about the next book, and I keep doing more reading, and I am working on it. So I'm gonna get on here and share more, like I'm doing now, so that y'all know that I'm working on it. COVID was not fine. COVID wasn't kind to my mental capacity. And some people were just super prolific, and I wasn't one of them. And you guys know that I just draw my pencil. Grab another pencil. But you guys, if you don't know, I do teach high school in the daytime, and I write and podcast in the evening. So it's like I have three jobs. But when I had to Zoom from home for 6 hours a day, and then everything was online. Hi, 50 Shades. It was really interfered. I don't know if you guys, any of you had that experience during that crazy year of just our whole lives are disrupted. And I feel really, I feel guilty, and I try not to feel guilty, but I do feel guilty that I wasn't able to just like do more. Anyway, there's that. So, let's see where... Oh, the chorus says, this is great, the tongue can turn a tiny provocation into a huge quarrel. Wise men avoid creating any conflict with their loved ones. So I guess isn't that true though? Like, again, back to humanity. So you could just say one thing and somebody gets offended, or you could just say it in the wrong way, or, and next thing you know, we've all maybe had that experience, right? Like, why you can't believe that something turned into like a bigger deal than it was, and you're like, how did that happen? And now you're like in a fight and you can't even pinpoint where you went wrong, what happened, and that wise men avoid creating any conflict with their loved ones. And I think that kind of speaks to the idea that your family, right? We always say blood is thicker than water, and it's always, our family is that first unit, the most intimate unit that we have our biggest disagreements with, and most painful ones too. I would, you know, even more so than with friends, because even though you might not want to talk to a family member anymore, they're still your family, right? So I thought that was interesting. So that's I'm about halfway through this one. And do you guys have any questions for me? You can ask me anything you want about mythology, the books, what I'm working on. And as you might be thinking of a question, here was something that I thought was interesting too. This is Menelaus says, Hellas was completely ignorant of arms. Oh, he says, Helen's heartaches didn't arise from her own free will, but from the gods. So going back to what I was talking about earlier, that she was, that rebuttal that he was giving to Peleus, like, hey, it wasn't her fault. The gods made her do it. And furthermore, this worked in Greece's favor. Hellas was completely ignorant of arms and warfare, and the army found its way to manliness. Experience is mankind's greatest teacher. And I thought that's really interesting that he's equating basically manliness with warfare. And I've touched on that theme in my books and talked about it in my podcasts, where the definition of manhood is equated with violence and war. I find that interesting, especially when we think about where we're at. We still fight wars today, but I don't know I haven't really fully formed my ideas about that. I usually thoughts. And he says experience is mankind's greatest teacher. And you know, it's funny because it is our greatest teacher, but I find that it's maybe a lot like childbirth, right? So you go through something very painful, and then the joy at the end makes your mind a little bit muddled about what it was like, because you have the joy at the end, right? So warfare might be a great teacher for mankind, right? And so the victory is sweet if you're the loser. But see, again, this is Menelaus saying this, and Andromache was on the losing side, so there was nothing victorious. It was all torture and shame and grief for her and all the other Trojan women that were taken captive. So it's like we're doomed to forget, even in the victory, then we forget. So I find that interesting. Anyway, I think that's going to be it for now. So you guys see what I'm reading. And I'm doing, this is Diane Arson's Farlian, and that's her translation of all of these plays. And then, anyway, so I hope to see you guys again. And this was fun. I'll hop on again. And finish up some stuff about Andromache. So thank you so much for joining me on live today. Appreciate it. So I'm gonna sign out for now. Bye. Thank you.